If you would open your books to page 143, and open your Bibles to Matthew chapter 5. I feel like I'm sort of rushing around this morning, just getting in here just barely in the nick of time, but I was busy delivering a baby. And let me add, that was to class. So Don't draw any conclusions from that. Let's begin our class this morning with a prayer. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we're so thankful for this day. We're thankful for the beautiful days that we've had. We're thankful for the recent rain. We're thankful that you are aware of us, that you sustain us, that you provide for us in every way. And we pray, Father, that as we gather before you at this time, that you will be with us as we study from your word. Help us to be able to get those things from the scriptures that would help us to be encouraged, help us to be better servants and children in your sight. We're thankful for today being able together to worship. And we pray that we have prepared ourselves to provide a worship that will be pleasing in thy sight, that we will worship you in a manner that's well pleasing. We're thankful, Father, for your Son and for his sacrifice. We pray there's not a day that goes by that we don't give thanks for what he's done for us and what you've done for us in planning to bring him to us and to be able to participate in a relationship that would ultimately provide the salvation of our souls. We realize, Father, as we live before you upon this earth, that we make mistakes. And we pray that you'll look down upon us in tender mercy and forgive us of our sins. Help us to be more knowledgeable about sin and making sure that sin's not part of our lives. We know we live in a difficult world. So many influences for evil round about us on a daily basis. And help us not to grow weary in doing what is right, but to make the stand that we need to. We're mindful as we gather this morning of many in our midst who are desirous of our prayers, those who are struggling with their health, those who've lost loved ones, those who have problems and issues that we may not even be aware of. But we pray, Father, that we might encourage, we might lift up, that we might act as a family in caring for one another. We pray, Father, you'll bless us today. Bless us this morning in our studies. Be with us in the days ahead. One day on us and crown us, we ask in Christ's name. Amen. When we talk about Matthew chapter 5, the first few verses, as Jesus has ascended to a mount to talk to his disciples, and the indications are to all those who are following after him, a great multitude of people. As he gets to a point, up at a high point where he can talk to the masses that have assembled, we see Jesus convey to them those very foundational things that must be part of a Christian's life. And as we look at those things, we refer to at least the first part of it as the Beatitudes. The idea there, the word beatitude, is that that is a blessing or being happy. And some translations, I believe, even use that word happy are those who do this and that as they talk about the first few verses of chapter 5. We're all about pursuing happiness. That's just within our nature. What do I our very carnal mind is to do those things that make us happy. And so our human being, our makeup, is to pursue those things that bring happiness to our lives. Now, in that process, we are very influenced and we have a tainted view of what happiness is about. The world paints a picture of happiness, and basically, if you've ever seen maybe some kind of a Broadway kind of show, or if you've seen some of the old westerns, and maybe you've gone out to where they filmed those westerns, and you thought a town, and you get there and you look at it, and there's just this front piece that looks like a building, and then back behind it there's nothing. And that's what we refer to as a facade. And when we look at life, the world paints to us pictures of what will make us happy. And they're nothing more than facades. We think that if we make so much money, or that if we have so many of this kind of belonging or that kind of belonging, some material wealth, that's going to provide for us happiness. Well, Jesus is going to go through here in Matthew chapter 5, those things that make people truly happy. And, you know, if you were to take and talk about a little area of Scripture or a nugget that would be a small piece of something that you really concentrate on that would make your life so much better, these few verses in Matthew chapter 5 would be that. And we want to go over them and talk about them in detail and get some understanding of what Jesus is saying. One of the misperceptions that I think people have is they read a verse, let's just say, for example, verse 8. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Now, you look at that statement, that's a true statement. There's not a... anything wrong with that. But I'm afraid what we do so many times with the Beatitudes is we pick one and we say, well, you know, verse 5 there, blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. I'm a meek person. I'm a quiet person. I'm not somebody who is loud and boisterous and has to be heard. I'm sort of just a calm, meek person. So things are going to be good for me. Well, Jesus is not going down a list that says, okay, pick one of these, and by picking one of these and concentrating on one of these, this is going to get you happiness. That's not what it is. And so when we read these verses, how many times, I sort of feel like I've been guilty of this. I read one of these verses, I say, there's the key to happiness. But the point is that these are collective items. Jesus is saying you need to shape your lives by these biblical principles that will make you to become the kind of person that God is pleased with and that will totally shape our lives, build us into a complete person for God. And by the way, doing these things will bring about happiness. Now, that's not the way the world portrays it. Happiness is conveyed to us in terms of what I can get to satisfy myself. But the world lies. Satan lies. Even the drug dealer will tell you that his product will bring you happiness. Well, that may be true for some very small period of time, but then come the consequences of that. The addiction, the cost in terms of your life being destroyed. Those are the realities of drugs. And so we look at the world and the world paints a picture of happiness. Every time you get on the television, it's going to portray something that's going to make you just ultimately happy. And it's usually a product or it's something else, but they never will provide lasting happiness. These Beatitudes will provide lasting happiness, and that's why they're so important. And it's as if from the Sermon on the Mount, everything that Jesus tells us in any passage is leveraged somehow off of some of those passages. And so that's how important it is. But I wanted to go through them and look at them in more detail and have greater understanding of what they mean, so that we can hopefully come to a point of where we understand that these need to make up our lives. And as I said, they need to do it collectively. Don't pick out one and say, well, I'm sort of like that, so I'm pleasing to God. Because these are things that the child of God should have as part of their lives, showing as their character, their nature, that they would be pleasing to God. So we want to think of them in those terms. And we'll look at some of the blessings that are talked about here in Matthew chapter 5, and then as we get on further on into the lesson, we're going to look at some other passages, especially in the book of Revelations, that talk about the blessings that come. And you can understand that from the perspective, as we look at Revelations, it's a book that's written for the children of God, those who are members of the body of Christ who are suffering and are going to have to endure the times and trials that they go through in which they lived. And, you know, so many people today will look at Revelation and say, well, you know, that means in 2025 we're going to have this earthquake, or we're going to have this particular thing because Revelation says so-and-so. And they don't understand the book. So if you understand the book of Revelation written to persecuted Christians in the time of the Roman Empire, then you come to understand some of the things that are going on. But the whole point of Revelation is don't give up. There are some blessings that will come. And you may have to endure hardship, but they'll come. So we're going to look at those blessings, those beatitudes, as it were, in the book of Revelations also. But starting out in Matthew chapter 5, let's look at these particular passages with more detail and a magnifying glass and see if we can come to a better appreciation or understanding. Verse 3, as Jesus, verse 2, opened his mouth, he taught them, saying, blessed or happy are the poor in spirit. Now, what does it mean to be poor in spirit? Does it mean to have a bad perception of yourself? Does that mean, you know, I'm not really anybody. I don't, you know, I'm a nobody. And, you know, is that what we mean, poor in spirit? Okay, the idea of understanding where you are and what you need. I am someone who desperately needs God. I desperately need to come in a relationship with God. I am poor in spirit. I have the kind of understanding that says I really need something. And it's not material wealth, but it's what God can provide. I am poor in spirit. It doesn't mean I have a bad perception of myself, that I have some kind of a inferiority complex, but it's the idea that I have humbled myself and recognize that I need God. People can hear the gospel, they can be touched by it, and believe at the moment that they need to do something to change the life that they have. But there's this problem that we have as human beings on this earth. We never seem to be able to get over ourselves. And this is the idea here, that we have to have the kind of spirit, the kind of humility to get over ourselves and empty ourselves such that we can allow God to come in. You remember the parable that Jesus taught about the man who had the evil spirits, and the idea, the perception is it laid out there that they came in, they cleaned his house, they swept it out, they made it a clean place, but then the evil spirits came back. And the point of that is the fact that I can come before God. I can have a moment before God. Let's say someone hears a lesson and they say, you know, that lesson touched me today. I know there's some things I need to clean up in my life. And they say, you know, I'm going to respond. And so they come forward, they say, you know, I've these problems in my life. So I haven't been faithful. I've done things I shouldn't have. And, you know, along those lines. Not that they're not sincere. But what happens is you make that confession. You have the intentions at this moment in time of making changes in your life. But then you go out and you start back into your normal routines of life. And you don't make changes there. And who you have contact with, who you have association with, what you do with your life, and guess what? It's going to come right back in there. And so when we talk about the poor in spirit, we're talking about those who have an understanding that I need to take things that are in my life and I need to get them out if I'm going to serve God. And I need to let God come into my life and reign within me. And so I need to make that decision, but that's a decision that's not a spur-of-the-moment decision, but that's a decision we make every day of our lives. Who's in control of your life every day when you get up? Now stop and think about it. And think about the days that you have. Who is in control of your life? Now, when we come to the conclusion of some things that Paul mentioned, in Romans chapter 6 and in Galatians chapter 2, that I'm dead. It's no longer me that lives, but there's this new person that has been resurrected from the grave of baptism, and that new person is governed and fueled by Jesus Christ. So when we get to the point that we empty ourselves and we let God come into our lives and the way he intends to come in there, not with caveats, not with, well, you can sort of govern my life to an extent until I want to do something and then I'm going to step in and then that's the way it's going to be. When we get to a point where we can say, I'm just going to just pour myself out, and then what's going to come back into me is going to be Jesus living in my life. And that we make decisions based on what Jesus would do and what he's instructed us to do and what God wants in our lives. We're talking about that kind of poor in spirit. And so that's a huge change. I mean, you stop and think about it. We're not going to lose our personalities. We're not going to lose our very nature, our character. We're not going to some extent, we're going to still be the same people, but we're going to be better people. Because what's governing me and what's motivating me is Jesus Christ and the truth of the Scriptures. That's what's going to motivate my life. Not what I want. Not what I see, not my desires. That's got to go away. That's going to be emptied. And when we're at that point, when we recognize the devastating nature of sin, and we say, okay, that can't be in my body. That can't be a part of me. That's got to go away. That's the kind of spirit we're talking about, that then has the ability to receive and make the changes necessary in our lives. We can't do it haphazardly. It's not going to be, well, today I recognize, you know, I'm sort of moved by what was said on a particular occasion, and, you know, or somebody else did something that sort of made me think a little bit, and because of that, I'm going to make a change in my life. If that change is not permanent, if that change is not an emptying of ourselves, then it's been of none effect for us. It does me no good to render obedience to the gospel and then go out from that point forward and live in the world like I did before. And we've got to understand that. That's the kind of poor in spirit that we're talking about. So when you take that understanding of what that means to be poor in spirit, what does he say here? Blessed are the poor in spirit for what? Theirs is the kingdom of heaven. These are the kind of people that are needed to make up the kingdom of heaven. You ever been around like a 4 or 5 year old? Now, they're still pretty cool individuals, even though the world has some bad things that they teach kids today. But you take a 4 or 5 year old off to the side and just deal with them, and for the most part, you're going to see a smiling face, a willing attitude. Jesus would say to his apostles, as they, disciples at the time, I guess, that would prevent the children to come to Jesus, and he said, suffer or let the children come unto me, for of such is the kingdom of heaven. What's he talking about? That the kingdom of heaven is going to be made up of little kids? No, that's not what he's talking about. But the attitude of a child, they'll believe what you tell them. They're happy. They're smiling. They'll go, you know, they're willing. Sometimes as adults, you know, we're sort of ornery. You know, you're not going to get me to do something I don't want to do. But a little child, the attitude of a little child, they basically are wide open. They're an open book. You want something you don't want to be repeated, you don't say something around a child. Or they'll repeat it at the most inopportune time. Because that's the way kids are. And that's the kind of thing we're talking about. This humble attitude, this willingness, this openness, this empty vessel, as it were, for God to come in and to fill up with all the goodness that he wants in our lives. So if we are poor in spirit, guess what? Ours is the kingdom of heaven. This is what the kingdom of heaven is going to be made up of. And there's no place in the kingdom of heaven for us to be sour people, for us to be mean, crusty old people. That's not what the kingdom's made up of. So this is an important understanding. Jesus is going to lay all this out. And obviously, you hear something like this for the first time, and it's overwhelming. If Jesus came and occupied the pulpit today and got up and started talking about these passages in the Sermon on the Mount and just said what he said and sat down, we would, what did he mean? What does he mean to be poor in spirit? I'm poor. I don't have much at all. I barely make it from meal to meal. I'm poor. Is that what he's talking about? No, that's not what he's talking about. And we can be the poorest people materially on this earth, but we can be the happiest, because we'll receive what God wants us to have in our lives. You see, the problem that we have today is we have this me problem, and you know, it's just too obvious. Otherwise, I wouldn't say anything about it. we have this me problem. I will be a child of God as long as, and that's how we basically state it. In our minds, we won't say that out loud. But I'll be a child of God as long as it doesn't interfere with this, or as long as I don't have to give this up. And that's how we want to serve God. And Jesus is saying, if you've emptied yourself, you recognize that your spirit, your being, is going to be replaced with what God wants in your lives, then yours is the kingdom of heaven. And that's powerful. Extremely powerful. And so as we look at these passages, and of course, we have such a privilege of having the written word. We don't want to ever take that for granted, because we can comprehend some of the sayings of Jesus that to people in his time, they went away scratching their heads. But if they thought about it, that's why parables were such powerful lessons. Those who didn't really want to delve in and understand what Jesus was saying, they went away saying, this man's just nuts. What was that he said? It didn't even make sense. But for someone who was wanting to understand, and for someone who had the kind of spirit to recognize what was going on in their lives and what they needed to get out of their lives, the parables were powerful lessons. And so this is what we're seeing here. These things have so much meat to them, and it's certainly worthy of our study and meditation. Blessed are the poor in spirit. Ask yourself every day, am I poor in spirit? And if you say, I don't think I'm poor in spirit, then there's something for you to work on, for you to be poor in spirit. Because if you're going to be a part of the kingdom, you need to be poor in spirit. All right, verse 4. Blessed are they that mourn. Take that on the surface. Blessed is something that is tragic in your life. Is there something that's overwhelming in your life? Is there something that's just really weighing you down? Well, that's great. Is that what he's saying? No. The idea here conveyed in this verse is, blessed are they that mourn about their conditions. Blessed are they that mourn about the sin that's in their lives. I can't be part of God and his kingdom if sin is in my life. I am in such a state of depravity, as it is, or as it were, that I am in a state that it's so bad, because I recognize sin. I don't try to doctor it up. I don't try to pretty it up. I don't let the world dictate to me what's sin and what's not sin. We don't want to talk about that anymore. If it's brought up and you use the word sin in a conversation, it'll almost floor somebody, because there's not anybody that talks about sin anymore. But Jesus is conveying here to them, blessed are they that mourn, that see the state that they're in, who see the fact that sin has been so devastating. I guess some of my favorite commercials, and that's probably a warped thing to say, maybe I need to rephrase that. I think most interesting commercials are the cigarette commercials. You've seen the one where they show the lady at 52 and they revert back to her earlier high school or college picture. This vibrant young lady, she said, I smoked cigarettes 2 packs a day or something. She says, the limit of my maneuverability is how long the oxygen tank will let me go, the tube on the oxygen tank. And so he lifts up her shirt and so shows a big half moon scar on her back. That's what smoking does. But what do people tell you that smoking does? Oh, this is great, you need it, you know, you need it. There is a big, huge escalation in the young people in this country that are starting to smoke. Did we not conquer that? Did we not show the dangers of smoking? Secondhand smoke, we got it out of all our businesses. You go to most restaurants today and they say, no smoking in here. Why? Because of the dangers of secondhand smoke. And yet the world today is still glamorizing cigarette smoking. It still has the same results of people who are dying at an early age because of lung cancer and those things associated with smoking. COPD, and people have seen commercials about it. They get elephants sitting on their chest. They can't hardly breathe. That's associated with, a lot of times, with lung cancer or smoking. That's what the world paints as the picture. We don't see sin for sin. And Jesus says, blessed are those who can see sin and mourn over it. Those people that can see the problems that exist because of sin. If you don't have an attitude towards sin that you mourn over it, then what would you expect that your attitude towards sin is going to be? Well, I would say you either are going to be tolerant of it, don't say anything, but just sort of tolerate, or you are going to be one who wants to engage and embrace sin. And Jesus said, if you're going to be part of serving God, you've got to be able to mourn over sin. This is not mourning over the loss of a loved one or the tragedies that we face in life. That's a natural thing that's going to happen to us. He's not talking about people who have some kind of hardness in their heart toward other individuals and toward occurrences that come up where it's tragic and they just sit there and say, well, not a big deal. That's not the mourning he's talking about. We're talking about the mourning that takes place over recognition of sin. Blessed are they that mourn. Everybody's going to mourn on this earth, that lives on this earth. From an emotional standpoint, they're going to mourn. Maybe some more than others. Maybe some will do it inwardly more than outwardly. They're going to mourn. But what he's talking about here is those who mourn over sin. For he says, what's going to happen to them? They'll be comforted. Now, we have to understand that when Jesus came to this earth, Jesus didn't come to this earth to try to make people's lives better from a materialistic or a physical standpoint. Yes, he healed people that came to him with infirmities. We know he did these things to demonstrate that he was the Son of God. He had compassion on them. But we're not talking about the mourning that we experience all in life as human beings, because that's not going to end. There's never going to be an end to that. Because as long as we live, there are going to be circumstances that cause us to mourn. But if we mourn over sin, there's going to be comfort. Because if we have that kind of attitude, then we are going to do what's necessary to get ourselves away from sin, out of sin, and then we're going to be comforted because we have the knowledge that God is pleased with us because of the way that we view sin and how we stay away from it, that we're trying to be like Christ. We're following in the path that he has set for us. So that's the kind of thing that we're talking about here. Jesus is talking to his disciples about changing their lives. Just totally restructuring their lives. And people today want to take these passages and some of the things that Jesus said, and that Jesus was just kind and Jesus was compassionate. And as long as I say I believe Jesus was God's Son, and I believe that he came to this earth to make it a better place. then that ought to be good enough. Because I recognize who Jesus is. But that doesn't get us out of sin. And Jesus came to this earth to do what? To seek and to save the lost. What does that mean? The scattered people of days gone by, Israel? No. Those that were lost in what? Sin. He came to seek and save those that were lost in sin. And so his messages are going to be about how do we get ourselves into a situation that is pleasing to God, that is acceptable to God, and so we have to be poor in spirit to receive the gospel and to let it work in our lives. And we have to be those who mourn over sin. So we will change our lives. We'll be comforted by knowing that we have done what God has asked us to do. And we're acceptable to Him. Verse 5. Blessed are the meek. Now, some people read that passage right there, and they'll say, well, blessed are those who are timid. That's what that means. Blessed are those who are timid. It's not what that means. We've talked about it in this class, I know, a number of times, that meekness is strength under control. That's what it is. Strength under control. Was Jesus meek? Yes. Strength, not weakness, strength under control. I think in the looking at the lesson book, he talks about someone that's meek being devoid of arrogance. And I think there's some truth to that. If we're meek people, we're not going to be arrogant people. But we're people who are under control. We're not people who are going to be moved about by everything that comes up and people pushing us one way or another. And see, that's where the true strength comes in. How are you going to be as a Christian? What does James say about the man who wavers? He talks about the double-minded man. It's a man can't make up his mind. Things come into his life, and he's just like, well, sort of just being tossed like the wind would push the wave, the grains in the field as the wind moves it back and forth, however it wants to control them. But the meek man is the man who's going to be able to stand and to do what's right regardless of the pressures and without becoming someone who is outraged or becoming quick-tempered or showing forth his aggravation emotionally or through some physical violence of some kind. Those who are going to be children of God are going to be well-grounded, are going to stand firm in the midst of trials. And this is an important one. Because what's going to come to the Christian? Trials. Problems. You're not going to live in this world and not be affected by the things going on round about you. You're going to be pressured. There'll be pressures on every hand. But the man who is meek is a man that can withstand and stay where he is. The meek, he says, shall inherit the earth. If you're someone who's not going to go anywhere, you're not going to be pushed around, but you're not going to be someone who loses perspective and loses their control, I want somebody like that to be on my side. Have you ever seen situations where, I know I've seen in the sporting world many times, where when the pressure was really on, when it was at that point where you needed to perform to the best of your ability, I have seen young men melt down. Things that were well under their control. Maybe it was a ball game that was under their control all the way except for the last 2 minutes. And then they reacted in such a way that cost them the victory. I want people on my side. The Lord wants people on His side that will be strong and under control to be part of His kingdom. That means we have to change. In the world in which we live in, the typical response, if someone pushes you, you push back. And you push back harder. If someone's going to do something to me, I'm going to get back at them. That doesn't fulfill our definition of meekness. And for us to consistently stay firm and grounded and rooted, we must take on this attitude of having strength, being under control, and not being people who lash out, and not being people who strike out at people. So when we talk about the meek, we're not talking about people who we would refer to today as wimps, or people who are timid, just don't talk very much, we don't see much come out of them. We're talking about people that will be under control for God. And to be people who will be like Christ. When Christ was being beaten, when Christ was being questioned, you don't think He had the ability to do different things? Jesus said, to Peter, when he caught off of Malchus, the high priest, the servant of the high priest's ear, he said, "Peter, put your sword up. That those who live by the sword will die by the sword." And if I had wanted to have to be delivered from this, I could have called down legions of angels to have myself to be protected. But Jesus went the way of meekness to His death upon the cross. And if we're going to be His followers, we're going to have to learn to be meek. Does that mean we're weak? No, we're not weak. Do you consider Jesus to be weak? Could you take a beating from the Roman scourging, which was usually referred to as the whip as the cat of nine tails, which had rocks and sharp things tied to nine tails that was drug across the back, which opened up your flesh, and then compelled to carry His own cross, which would not have been light, and you want to call Him weak? Many people died just in the scourgings alone. Jesus was meek, strength, under control. And we as Christians must be under control and serving God and recognizing that this world is not our home. And that we act like Christians in ways we conduct our lives. These Beatitudes will make us happy. If we serve God the way He's prescribed in these Beatitudes, it makes our lives better. It makes us happy people because what we are filling our happiness with are not temporary things that give temporary satisfaction and will fade away, but He's given us the ability to have the character in our lives to have things that are sustaining with eternal measures. Next week we'll continue here at this point and try to get through the rest of these. Give some thought to reading the Beatitudes this week and trying to come to a deeper understanding of what God has planned for us.